Please stand.
Come on, okay. Come on, are you okay?
You wait for my name. Lost. All the dirt out. Okay. Oh, not okay. I'm done.
Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor powers nor things present nor things to come, nor height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. We brought nothing into this world, and we can take nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. Everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die." Please be seated. Welcome to St. Canice's Apropos for Erik's funeral, or to give him his full title, Air Vice Marshal Sir Erik Bennett, CBO, KBE, CB. Erik was a much-loved brother, uncle, great-uncle, and friend to many people. And his loss, though expected, comes so close to the loss of Shirley shortly before Christmas. On behalf of the family and of this parish church, welcome to so many people from far and wide, from the United Kingdom and other nations, and a special welcome to representatives from the Omani Embassy in London. Though the COVID restrictions have relaxed in many ways, as we know, we are still asked to wear our masks, and we are still advised not to shake hands and to avoid physical contact. But yes, we are fortunately allowed to sing now, even though we are wearing masks. And one practical thing has just been made clear to me, that the toilet in the car park has been opened now, so it is there for your use. We are meeting in the name of Christ, who died and was raised by the glory of God the Father. We have come here today to remember before God our dear sister, our dear brother Erik, to give thanks for his life, to leave him in the keeping of God, his Creator, Redeemer, and Judge, to commit his body to be buried, and to comfort one another in our grief, in the hope that is ours through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And therefore we pray that here today we may know the peace of Christ in communion with all God's faithful servants. Would you please stand? And I'd like to ask Judy to come forward.
God of all consolation, whose son Jesus Christ was moved to tears at the grave of Lazarus, his friend, look with compassion on us, your children, in our loss. Give to our troubled hearts the light of hope, and strengthen us in the gift of faith. In Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us now sing the first hymn, O Lord my God, when I am also in wonder, I begin to the very end of this service.
How great thou art.
become an essential part of this service when we remember that neither Erik himself nor any one of us here is without sin, and that we all need the mercy and forgiveness of God. As children of a loving Heavenly Father, let us seek the forgiveness of God, for He is full of gentleness and compassion. Call to remembrance, O Lord, your compassion and your loving kindness, for they have been from of old. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember not my sins, nor my transgressions, but according to your mercy, think on me. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
O keep my life and deliver me. Put me not to shame, for I have put my trust in you. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May God our Father forgive us our sins and bring us to the eternal joy of his kingdom, where dust and ashes have no dominion. Amen. Merciful Father, hear our prayers and comfort us. Renew our trust in your Son, whom you raised from the dead. Strengthen our faith with all who have died in the love of Christ, will share in his resurrection, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the first reading.
Reading from John 14, verses 1 to 6 and 27. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid.
While we remain seated, we say the 23rd Psalm. If you could please say the verses in heavy type. The Lord is my shepherd, therefore can I lack nothing. He shall refresh my soul and guide me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me. You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup shall be full. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. You remain seated for the second reading, led by Hazel Adam.
Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 to 7. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. The first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and no longer was there any sea. I also saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, standing out of heaven from God, made ready as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne say, Behold, God's dwelling place is among men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be with them, and wipe away all every tear from their eyes. Death shall be no longer, nor mourning, nor crying, nor any further pain, because the former things have passed away. Then he who was seated on the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. He also said, Write, for these words are trustworthy and true. And he told me, It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To him who is thirsty, I will give him without charge from the fountain of the water of life. The victor shall inherit all this. I shall be his God, and he shall be my son.
I'm very touched to have been asked by the family to say a few words of reflection about the amazing Erik Bennett. As someone who spent 30 years as a Member of Parliament, some of it as Foreign Minister, I can honestly say that the one person I was most fortunate to meet and who had the greatest influence on me and my career was Erik. I met him soon after I was elected to Parliament in John Major's surprise victory at the 1992 general election. And one senior MP had occasional gatherings at his Westminster home, where over a good dinner and plenty of wine, the great foreign policy issues of the day were discussed. It tended to focus on the Middle East and the United States. And it was at one such occasion that I was introduced to Erik as a young MP who had an RAF father and an interest in the Middle East from my earlier years as an oil trader. From then on, Erik took a generous, avuncular interest in my fortunes and drew my political progress into his own extraordinary diplomatic and royal existence. By the time I met him, he had already enjoyed a remarkable life and established a role that was unique. The journey through his early RAF career to his wider loyal service thereafter is unparalleled in modern times. Given that Erik was very private and discreet, it took some time for me to piece together some of the elements of his earlier life. A career RAF officer and pilot in the 50s and 60s, sometime around 1971, he became air advisor to the young King Hussein of Jordan, and on occasions also his pilot. He is said to have saved the king's life when over the Bekaa Valley with Erik at the controls, their plane was threatened by Israeli jets. A rapid barrel roll and some skillful piloting to evade being shot down earned Erik the King's everlasting gratitude. Less threatening, perhaps, was when he was returning with King Hussein from a visit to Emperor Haile Selassie in Ethiopia. The Emperor had given the King a gift. It was a young lion cub. And while refueling halfway back to Jordan, the lion escaped. And one of Erik's most prized photographs was that of the young king chasing the scampering little lion down the runway. He retained a deep affection for Jordan. And unknown to many, Erik was godfather to the current king, Abdullah. The RAF service sometimes also took him to Oman and Yemen, and this widened his knowledge of and reputation in the Arab world. And so it was that in 1973, Britain's then Foreign Minister, Julian Amory, who was a friend of King Hussein and well-versed in the ways of the Middle East, spotted Erik and recommended to the new Sultan of Oman that he was just the man to set up his air force. Sultan Qaboos, aged only 30, had become the ruler of Oman in 1970 after deposing his father, British. As a former foreign minister, I should quickly point out that we don't do that sort of thing anymore. Over the course of the next 20 years, during the 70s and 80s, Erik turned the Royal Air Force of Oman into the most capable operation in the Gulf. He started it from nothing. He ensured its pilots were properly trained and professional, and that their aircraft were modern and well-maintained. One of his favorite quips was to say that a general goes into battle with lots of soldiers alongside him. When you're piloting a plane, you're in the front on your own. And the best of the Royal Air Force in the UK was transplanted into the new Royal Air Force of Oman. His loyalty to our own Air Force remained. A few years ago, he remarked to the Queen's private secretary that he'd noticed that no member of the royal family had ever worn RAF uniform at the Cenotaph on Remembrance Sunday. In every year since, Prince William has done so. Erik was forever indebted to Julian Amory for his patronage. He regarded him as his mentor, and he felt his debt to him was only complete once he successfully inspired Richard Bassett's excellent biography entitled Last Imperialist, A Portrait of Julian Amory. He always kept in touch with the family after Julian's death in 1996 and valued the continuing Amory connection. Now, he just concluded his 20 years as commander of the Air Force when I was privileged to meet him. As I moved from oil trading to Parliament, he moved from the Air Force to the court of the Sultan. And it's no exaggeration to say that it marked the start of the next half of my life, so much so that in the last few years, I've often described Erik as my not quite godfather. After passing on his RAF command to a capable Omani, he spent the next 20 years as one of the closest advisors to the Sultan. That closeness was made even closer by one fatal incident. In 1995, His Majesty was driving in the hills of Salalah in southern Oman with Erik as one passenger, along with the then Prime Minister Qais Sarwawi and his brother Omar. A large truck smashed into the car. Qais was killed outright, and the injured Erik, he was saved by a brilliant young soldier who applied firm pressure to his bleeding temple. I began to be asked to visit Oman each year for National Day, for New Year, the Sultan, and on many other occasions. And there was never a conversation with Erik in which he didn't drop a small pearl of wisdom or significant fact from the past. For those who don't know Oman, it is a very beautiful and special country. In the 50 years from 1970, Sultan Qaboos developed it from poverty and no infrastructure to a modern functioning state. And Erik played a special part in that national journey. Now, Erik divided his life between Oman, the UK, and the islands he loved. Those of us who knew him well understood that he kept these aspects of his life in very separate compartments. He was an intensely private man. Indeed, this is perhaps the first and only occasion on which all the strands of his amazing story all come together. He used to fly his helicopter to Ireland, and he told me once in his inimitable way, "I thought it was all over. The engine coughed over the Irish Sea." Well, fortunately, it only sputtered and didn't stop, thus leaving him to become the oldest person ever to retain a valid helicopter license. Part of knowing him so well also involved, I am pleased to say, many a good lunch. The Michelin-star fat duck on a Sunday required a spin down the M40 in his Bentley, and he'd drive the car there, but sensibly, indeed fortunately, his driver would drive us back. His regular haunt in London was Wilton's, where he had his regular table, and these highly enjoyable occasions brought out Eric's teasing, whimsical humour. Eric, to a waiter, "How many oysters should I have?" "9, sir." "Oh, I didn't know you spoke German." More special than all of them were our quarterly lunches with Margaret Thatcher at the Ritz. And once, when she stood to leave, the entire dining room burst into respectful applause. He had some favourite words of wisdom which would pop up every now and then, such as, "Don't confuse movement with progress," and "Who do you think polices the police?" And there was another about people who talk rubbish, which I would have to tell you outside the walls of this church. The London office he ran for the Sultan was a special link with politics, government, and Buckingham Palace. He was the glue between the Sultan and the Queen, who personally awarded him the CVO during her official visit to Muscat. The relationship between Oman and the UK was genuinely special, and something which prompted Eric to muse, "I'm in the service of two monarchs." Eric attracted devoted loyalty and was well served in both the countries he worked with. Mother and daughter Christine and Kate Newton served him for years in London with masterly social skill and efficiency. In Oman, very special to him were his loyal driver and aide, Hilal al-Rahi, and the remarkable brigadier Mohammed bin Suleiman al-Ghazali. Mohammed is here today. Eric trusted and depended on him. He was his main contact and support for many years, and especially for the last two or three. Mohammed's loyal and devoted care were essential to maintaining the quality of his final years. So my reflections today, perhaps to many, bring to life for the first time a side of Eric about which they knew very little. But all of you in here in Ireland and all his family can understand more clearly that their own life has been touched by a quite remarkable man. He was known as a tough commander, but all who ever worked with him loved and respected him because he was firm but fair. He was intellectually inquisitive, he was a wise teacher, he was a unique man of dignity, service, and remarkable modesty. And so today, Eric Bennett, we all remember your unique life and we salute you.
Let us stand, sing the hymn, "Love Divine, All Loves Except."
Oh, We extend a special welcome to Mr. Issa Achilani and his colleagues from the South Military of Oman Embassy in London, to the military attaché from the British Embassy, to Mr. Nigel Windsor, who is representing the Royal Geographical Society. We welcome to all of you who can't be here in person and who are watching the live stream of the service. We are so sorry that Uncle Eric's sister June is not well enough to be here today. We are thinking of you, Auntie June, and we hope that you make a full recovery. We remember Uncle Eric's late brother and sisters, Bob, Ketty, and Rita. And we are thinking of Larry and Shirley, whom, sadly, we lost in the past year. The wheel has come full circle. 3/4 of a century ago, Uncle Eric left County Leash to seek his fortune elsewhere, and now he has returned. That decision to leave was witnessed by Mick Lopeman, who is here today, and who knew Uncle Eric long before any of the rest of us did. Mick remembers him standing in the middle of a sugar beet field on a bitterly cold winter's day and declaring, "I've had enough of this farming. I'm out of here." On balance, not a bad decision. When we were children, Uncle Eric was for us an exotic, romantic figure who led a life of adventure in far-off lands. He was bigots. He was a tanned movie star who appeared as if by magic, usually in a big Mercedes car, which he would drive very fast to thrill and terrify us. A pair of his cast-off flying boots stood incongruously next to my father's Wellington boots, a constant source of wonder. As we grew up, we got to know him better. He came to Ireland once or twice a year, and he loved catching up with the family. He was very generous. He hosted lunches and dinners, which, no surprise this, were planned with military precision. Lavish hampers arrived at Christmas. He and his siblings all loved reading, and they regularly exchanged books. He took a keen interest in our lives. If he was here at Christmas, he used to enjoy following the fox hunt. The big worry was how to keep him warm. Boilers and stoves worked overtime throughout his visits. Uncle Erik was always au fait with Irish current affairs, and of course, he loved discussing and debating Irish politics. I remember him being particularly fascinated by the melodramatic life of our former teacher, Charles Hoddy. He waxed lyrical about Oman and its people, and he loved to tell us about developments in the country. Over the years, we followed his career with enormous pride. His life retained the allure of mystery, which of course added to our fascination. He regularly admonished us for our curiosity with too many questions. And as Sir Alan said, I think we've learned more in the last few days about that other side of his life than we ever knew. In recent years, as his health deteriorated, his trips back to Ireland slowed to a trickle and eventually stopped. And phone conversations had to suffice. We were immensely comforted by the knowledge that he was being cared for so well in every way. This is a very sad occasion for us, but it is also an occasion of celebration. We have come together to commemorate the extraordinary life of a wonderful man, a life of rich achievement and fulfillment. We have so many people to thank. Reverend Richard, for compiling the order of service so thoughtfully and conducting it so beautifully. Archdeacon Murray, for your prayers at the house. Church Warden Freddie Hancock, and I believe we should thank you for performing a miracle with the electrics beforehand. Sir Alan Duncan, for your marvellous eulogy. Funeral Director Kieran O'Sullivan and your team, for your professionalism and kindness. Mike Beattie and Kate Newton, for your invaluable input and wise advice. The various in Oman and the British Embassy for their help with assembling all the necessary documentation. Brigadier Mohammed Al-Yazidi for dealing with the myriad procedures required to make Uncle Erik's return possible and for accompanying him to Ireland. Above all, we thank you, Mohammed, for everything you have done to ensure that Uncle Erik is looked after superbly, with such kindness and such love. It is a privilege for us to meet you at last. Uncle Erik was very generous in his support for various charities and organizations. St. Mungo's, a homeless charity based in London, was dear to his heart. If you wish, you might like to make a contribution to St. Mungo's in his memory, either online or in the collection box at the back of the church. And finally, you are all invited for a meal in Roundwood House after the service. You will find printed directions to the house at the back of the church. It will be a unique opportunity for us to meet each other and no doubt share stories and memories of Uncle Erik, Sir Erik, his life and times.
May I speak in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we have just been hearing, words have been said by Sir Alan and by Roger just now In other words, by people who knew him as a loved member of the family or who loved him as a friend. My brief words are more to give a reflection, perhaps, on the meaning of what has been said, and to play my part in offering up this man into the care and love of our Heavenly Father. We are saying goodbye this afternoon to a man whose achievements in life have been quite extraordinary, but what really stands out for me is that he left school, the King's School in Dublin, before he could take his leaving certificate. And the part of working on the family farm, as we heard for just a short while, but couldn't see a future for himself during this, tried accounting in Dublin for a brief period, and then went to Belfast in 46. Joined the RAF as air craftsman and worked his way, as we know, up to the heights, as it were. And during this time, yes, he went to Jordan to organise and train their air force, and then he was asked to do the same for Oman. But what is so interesting and amusing to me, there, a man with no leaving certificate has achieved something totally extraordinary. Yes, his achievement showed him to be a man of great energy and purpose. Someone who lived life to the full, which we're all meant to do. He clearly had a love for and an interest in his nephews and nieces, his siblings, including June, his only surviving sister, and that he had a great capacity for friendship, which included, as we know, the Sultan of Oman and the people of Oman. He loved the way the country was being developed. He was a thoughtful man, and his capacity for friendship, his desire for the improvement of the lot in life of others, is part of the man that we are offering up to the Lord. He was a very organized man, as I suppose we would expect. He was very interested in people. He did many acts of kindness to others, and had a wide range of interests in UK, Irish, and world politics. He was keen on sport and supported Chelsea as his football club in the UK. Enjoyed deep sea fishing. He was a keen reader, and he was naturally diplomatic. And when he was able to visit the family during the year back in Ireland, yes, he used to host a family party in a restaurant in Cork or Cashel or Dublin or whatever. And the family would always look forward to his Christmas Harrods hamper. When someone we love dies, there is always a hole in our lives which cannot be filled. Erik has left some hole in many people's lives and in different countries. I do not know about the depth or otherwise of any religious faith that he might have had. He may have been deeply committed to God, or he may not, I do not know. But a life filled with kindness and friendship, a life of integrity, desiring the best for others, and working for the best interests of others, are all clearly signposts that he was living in the light of God. We are all being blessed with the gift of life from the Lord, and Erik lived that life to the full. We have been offered the opportunity to see that when we die, this is not the end of us. Rather, it is a new beginning for which God has been preparing for us in this life. The Lord welcomes us. And let us not forget that God's love for us is infinite, that he knows us far better than we know ourselves. We come to God, warts and all. And our Lord is a God who welcomes us, works within us to bring healing, blessing, and new life. A God of compassion and understanding and mercy, who will not rest until we all reach our fulfillment and destiny, which lies with him and with one another. And let us remember the Lord Jesus' words as he hung on that cross and spoke to the repentant thief beside him. Today, you will be with me in paradise. Let us remember that the Lord himself died for us that we might be forgiven, and that he rose again that we might know the joy of eternal life. And so with this faith, we offer Erik into the care and keeping of Almighty God. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. In a moment of quiet, let us turn to God in prayer for Erik and for ourselves. Merciful Father, thank you for all that Erik meant to us as much loved brother, uncle, member of the family, and friend. Thank you for all that he contributed to the well-being of humanity, for his thoughtfulness, generosity, and kindness, for his capacity for friendship, for his service in the RAM, and for his service in Jordan. We entrust him into your care and keeping, you who gave him life and who holds and cares for him now. Thank you for the joyful news of resurrection and eternal life, that our lives are not over and done when we leave this world, but are only just beginning. We entrust him into that life, peace and joy which you have promised, and which hope we can see and feel in our Lord Jesus Christ. Almighty God, Father of all mercies and giver of all comfort, deal graciously, we pray, with those who mourn, that casting all their care on you, the consolation of your love, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And let us join together in the traditional words of the Lord's Prayer. And so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now let us sing the final hymn, Onward Christian Soldiers.
With the cross of Jesus, oh,
Promises. We now leave your servant Erik in your gracious keeping. In the name of Jesus our Lord, who died and is alive, and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us remain standing as the bearers come forward to take Erik's coffin out to the churchyard. Thank you. Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace, according to thy word. For my eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people,
to be a light to the light of the Gentiles.
Thank you.